First world, come in and take a seat. Pay us no attention, it's all conspiracy.
We have satire and parodies, some funny, some perverse. If none of it's offensive to you, you'd be the first.
Get a cappuccino soon, I'm gonna strangle somebody.
You know, this is, excuse me, a damn fine cup of coffee. Damn good coffee. And hot.
Listen to me very carefully, because I'm only going to say this once. Coffee. Black.
This town needs an enema.
Don't just sit right down. Relax. Open your ears real wide and say, give it to me straight, doctor. I can take it.
Take the the chops out from under the wheels. Blast up. No offense, Margaret. Contact. We're off. Brum, brum.
Doctor, doctor, give me the news. I got a bad case of loving you.
Oh, what hearts will hear. On with the show. This is it.
The doctor is in, baby, and Pariah is live on Indiegogo. Still shadow banned, but the link is pinned. Get over there and help a young, fresh face break into comics. Hey, so listen, Tanner couldn't be here with me this morning, so I've got a special guest host, guest co-host coming out. Let me bring this jewel of a human being out here.
I'm a strange guy.
Really?
Yeah, I worry. I mean, little things bother me.
And I see your Schwartz is as big as mine.
Do me a favor, please. Get out of here. Get out of here, man. Shit, I'm saying.
Good morning, Rich.
Good afternoon.
Yes, it is afternoon. Yep, yep. Over in the UK, Rich moved into his new flat. I launched a campaign. It's been a big week for us, pal.
A big freaking week, yeah, man. I lucked out too. I went to the British Heart Foundation where they have all the secondhand stuff, and they had a clearance of like 70% off everything. So I actually furnished my entire fucking flat. So I'm good.
I'm good. Nice, nice.
Yeah, man. Yeah, it's so far so good. You know, yeah, I'm almost tapped, but you know, it's okay. I don't mind. I really don't care at all.
That's right. The next paycheck's coming, baby. The next paycheck.
The next paycheck is definitely coming. And that's when I have to figure out what the fuck I'm going to get next. So sorry for the language, by the way.
Sorry. The professor. So, Rich, we got a guest today we're going to be talking to. I'm going to actually
bring her. Who could it possibly be?
We're going to bring her out early while I do the normal shenanigans we do here on the show.
We are. That's incredible. We should.
We're going to let her participate. Yes, a fresh young face, Carol. Shut up. Good morning, Dawn. Good to see you. Oh, man. Thank you, Shadowhawk. I appreciate your support, brother.
A great start. Yeah, man. Nicely done.
Oh, look at that. Shadowhawk says, holy shit, Rich shaved and looking at him. And Dawn is congratulating you on getting into your new place.
Good to hear, Rich.
Amy, mm-hmm. Amy, good for you guys.
I gotta get the stripper.
Rich. So Amy Good is a new face here on the Madness, and I'm not sure she knew what she was getting herself into, but she says it's her kind of crazy, and she's down with it. So let's bring her on in here. Wow. Amy Good, good morning.
Hey guys, how are you?
Doing good. Amy has a show here on the network.
If so.
Tell people about your show before we go into anything else.
Okay, so I have a show. It's live 7 p.m. Eastern time on Sundays here on the network. Pops asked me to do it, and I was like, sounds good. Let's do it, man. My co-host is somebody who I've worked with for a while. He's a great guy, and we don't really want to limit ourselves as to what we can talk about. So we consider it to be like anything entertainment. It just so happens that it's mostly about comics right now.
I hear you. James Hayes, good morning. And thank you for sharing that link. Always glad to have you here. So another Southern gentleman. And Brianna is here. We wouldn't call her Southern since she lives in one of those Scandinavian countries that no one really cares about. Brianna, I don't know why someone would unsubscribe you. I don't know.
Hi, James Hayes.
And I'm just kidding about the Scandinavian country thing. It does happen, though. So make sure you are subscribed, not just to the Madness, but subscribe over on my channel, Doc Blaylock. And be sure you give a thumbs up and ring the bell and do all that YouTube shit you got to do. I don't know these things, Brianna. I don't know. And Carol says, hello, new lady. Now, Carol Lee is the colorist, one of the colorists on my campaign. And she, I allow her out of the basement once a week to come on streams.
Oh my God.
So later we will throw the link out. But normally, Amy, we do some shenanigans around here before we get started. But I wanted to invite you to participate in the shenanigans.
So
we're gonna keep our segments going this morning. We're gonna start with the award-winning segment called Yes, indeedy. Hey, Pops, welcome, welcome, welcome.
I got a phone call right when the show started, Doc. That's why I had to bail.
Okay.
Q's not going to be at the draw stream tomorrow. He's hanging out with his mom. I just talked to him and his mom in a call. His mom's so sweet, dude.
Well, that's cool.
So everybody doesn't ask tomorrow, where's Q? He's hanging out with his mom this weekend.
All right. So Don says, hi, Amy.
Spoon.
Rich, bless his heart. Rich can't catch a break. And hello, Diggs. Welcome, welcome, welcome. Shadowhawk says, Amy, good to meet you. Now, Shadowhawk is a well-known supporter of all things Indie Comics, Comicsgate. He's a great guy. And Carol, we're not going to give Q any slack whatsoever about his mommy excusing him from the draw stream. That's just not going to happen. But we're doing meme review right now.
Doc, did you see your Facebook inbox?
Not in the last 5 minutes.
Well, look at it for a second, real quick.
No. What's wrong with your head?
No, that's my inbox to you on Facebook.
I just looked at it.
Yeah, that's what happened. That's for real. So, you know.
So meme number one. When you eat healthy for one day and check to see if your summer body is ready yet. This is me every year. Every year.
One day.
And somehow, by the way, somehow, leading this sedentary lifestyle of drawing, painting, and drinking coffee somehow doesn't get me the summer bod. So I've just embraced the dad bod is what I'm saying.
Don't forget all the cigarettes.
And the smoking. That's right. I was going to ask you, Amy, I know you fortified yourself before you came on stream. How long are you good for before the Nick fit gets all over you?
However long.
Oh, wow.
Fucking dog.
I don't have that kind of endurance.
Not everybody has to light one as they put one out, Doc.
Well, you know, I'm just saying. Like, you're one to talk, Pops. Listen. Stop the scrolling. I only went in for a burger.
Oh, my God.
This is what's called unfortunate placement.
Wow. All right, then.
Wow. All right. So then we have, you want cuddles here, go buy a dog.
This is why I like cats.
Yes, things only a cat would say. Things only a cat would say. Now, this one, we just talked about this, and it's not an old person thing, because this has been happening to me since I was a kid. My nose every night.
Ew. No, dude.
Every night. You know, you flip over to that one side so that one will unclog, you know.
No, gross, yeah.
And it's just, you know, it's a nightmare. It's a night. So, you know, indecent propositions, right? Yeah.
Well, they go well together.
They do it. That's one of those threesomes that actually works out.
Oh, yeah.
I want you to keep.
What the heck?
And I don't know. This one just struck my.
You know, I hope you can keep an open mind.
That one kind of fits because the the Imperials do kind of remind me of.
Yes, yes. Now, here's the thing, though. That looks like it could be in canon. I'm just saying. It fits.
It has to have the pew pews on it, though.
Yeah. This is a disarmed Imperial Volkswagen. Yeah.
It has pew pews on the front. It looks like little tiny ones.
That's an Imperial Streetwalker.
I'm making that meme. I am making that meme for next week. I'm not even shitting. Let me write that down. Imperial
Streetwalker. Oh my god.
Gonna put a thong on it too, though.
easy. So this has been another exciting episode of our award-winning yes. Scrolling through the chat here. James says, Jess Carroll's a comic book colorist. Open to work as I'm posted here. She is a colorist. She's available for hire. Stephen B. is in the chat. Good morning, Stephen B. Excuse me. Yes, the coughing is real. It is. Don says, well, you know, it could be fortunate placement. It just depends. Oh my goodness. So this morning again we're joined by Amy. We know that Amy has a show here on the network, but Amy also does our Amy, tell people who you are. Introduce yourself and by all means be entertaining because my show's dying here. Save me.
Oh my god, sorry. I have not had enough coffee yet, man, to like fucking totally wake up and get the brain charged up.
Bam.
I know, I got a brand new second one ready to go. All right, well, what do you want to know? So I got the show, and tomorrow, please tune in. We're going to be having Mike Barron on again, so he will be there tomorrow. I don't know how long he's going to be on, but if not, then I'll just have to fucking entertain people. That's cool. We can roll with the punches. Whenever I talk to him, it's like really off the cuff, so that's fine.
Mike Barron is a great guest to have on. Good
I
on
love,
you.
Yeah, I love yeah. him. He is awesome. He sent me a copy of one of his comics. Tomorrow we're going to be talking about Nexus. And I actually do writing, so he has been really sweet and made himself available to me to, you know, pick his brain. And I've watched his writing tips on YouTube. Dear God, they are very good. And he is so funny. So if you haven't watched those and you're interested in it, just give him a peek. The way that he talks, too, I have to say that I have never met anyone in my entire life who can communicate so much with so few words so efficiently. Like a 4-hour conversation, Mike can turn it into like 10 minutes. It's an art. It's fucking art.
Oh, yeah.
And I bought one of his books. I've actually sadly never read any of his books previous to the last couple weeks. He's actually a fantastic writer, genuinely hilarious.
Yes.
And
an all-around nice guy. So, yeah. But Amy, you're also an artist and a writer.
I am. My forte is art first, writing second. I have an echo. I don't know if that's my problem or not, so I'm turning my volume down. Sorry.
Yeah, it's absolutely your problem.
It probably is. I'm full of them. So yeah, my first love is art. I originally went to college for English to be a writer, but then I realized like, what the fuck do you do with that? Do you teach? Do you do journalism? Both of those things did not appeal to me. So way back when I was a teenager, I had like a fucking existential crisis about that. And my mom had said, everybody has gifts. Everybody has talents. Go with your gift. And I've been drawing since before I could formulate, you know, words cohesively on paper. So I have 2 undergrad degrees in visual art, and I've been doing illustration professionally for over 10 years now, probably 12 or 13 years. And I do write. I was at one point in a past life a published author, but since then the publishing company went under. The books are out of print. I may re-release some of them soon, but right now I have my hands chock full with working on comics. This is what I've been brought into by happenstance just a couple months ago.
Yeah, that's what I was going to ask you is,
yeah,
what fundamentally went wrong in your head to make you get into comics?
So this is embarrassing, but I knew absolutely nothing about comics before a couple months ago. Mm-hmm. I grew up in the 90s, so I was a video game person. Why would I read comics when I can play video games? And in fairness, you pretty much had to read all of them, like 5 billion times more to read in those than in comics, because that was pre, you know, voice acting for the most part. Mm-hmm. But so I didn't plan this. I didn't know shit about comics. I didn't understand the process. I didn't understand collecting or the fan bases or anything. And I'm ashamed to say that now, because it's a little bit of like an imposter syndrome when you walk into this and you're like, what am I doing here? But so the story with that, though, is I had been working at a company for a long time. My husband also worked there, and we were supposed to purchase the company, but things happened and some legal issues ensued. So I decided I'm out. Fuck this. I'm going to dedicate my life full time to my art. And because that wasn't what I wanted to do, I was helping set his career up for almost a decade doing this.
Excuse me.
I just kind of had like the fuck this moment. I don't give a shit what happens. Burn it down. I'm just doing my art. I don't care if I'm poor. I don't care if it doesn't work out. I don't care if I embarrass myself. This is ridiculous. And then as soon as I made that decision, I started getting propositions from people in the comic book industry. Hey, will you write this for me? Hey, will you edit this for me? Hey, will you help me do cover design? Hey, will you recolor shit for me? Like,
nice.
Now here I am and I do all of that.
Now, James Hayes is asking, and I already kind of know the answer to this, but he wants to know, you know, what projects are you working on? And Amy said there's a lot of them. She doesn't know if she's at liberty to talk about because
I'm under an NDA for several. And so the things I can talk about is, of course, First World, which my co-host on Sundays, that's how I met him. He hired me to write it. So I'm the writer, and it's extremely offensive. We make fun of everybody, right, left, and center. Every religious persuasion and every sexual orientation. I wrote that. I'll take all the flack for it. That's been a really good project. Issue 2 is coming out next month. We are launching the Kickstarter for it soon. And on top of that, he's also having me do animations. So I'm learning animation for it to do like sizzle reels and shit for side projects. I'm also working on a project that is kind of like a rip on the 2016 Ghostbusters. That's going to come out in summer. I'm the writer on that project. I have an enough artist. And then I'm also writing right now a short series for a fairly well-established indie comic that will release sometime in summer or fall.
Nice.
Then there's other NDAs that I'm not allowed to discuss, but those are specifically relegated to my art. I'm not writing any of those. I'm doing covers and variants and da 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 da, and that's very exciting. Hopefully one of them gets published pretty soon here. I don't know. I've seen all the work for it. I'm just scared that something could go wrong, because you always have that trepidation until like it's in your hands. You know what I mean?
Is it Wokebusters? I backed that one a while back.
Yes.
No, it's not Wokebusters. It's it's under a working title right now, so I don't know exactly what he's going to be calling it. But it's basically, making fun of how it's an ironic concept, because he's taking pot shots at how woke Ghostbusters was, but simultaneously there is some woke messaging in it. I'm not a woke person, but I won't turn down a project unless it really doesn't align with my moral values. But it's actually a very intelligent concept, and I appreciate the guy. He's been really cool to work with, and he's got really interesting projects that he wants to bring me on board with for as far, you know, into the future as we can enjoy working together.
You know, it's work. That's the job.
Yeah. It's work. And honestly, this guy, you know, I don't want to say too much, but he's definitely comes from a different political slant than I do. I'm like totally in the middle. I'm like almost a perfect centrist for whatever reason. And I've been all over in the past, right? He has a lot more left than me, and he has a lot of different feelings about things than I do, but we're able to talk and we're able to communicate and understand that and respect that. So that's fucking awesome. That's huge. And the ideas that he has are things I would never normally touch, but it harkens me back to my art school days. I went to school before all of the crazy mind disease sat in. So right. We were really encouraged to push our boundaries and be uncomfortable and experience things that we didn't agree with. That's actually how I went from being a left-leaning, like, classical liberal to really conservative after college through art school. Like, art school made me very, very conservative, actually.
Wow.
Yeah. Ironic.
Yes.
It was also a private school, though, so we didn't have public funding. It was over 10 years ago, so it was a great time to have your mind expanded, and I really appreciated that. I had professors that would say, hey, if you feel strongly about something, choose the opposite argument, do your project on that. Mm. And doing so, I actually came over to the other side. So I like to still do these projects when they come up, which is rare. So the projects he's having me do, a lot of them are like pro-LGBT and stuff like that, but they're not, it's not about that. Like, it just kind of has representation in it. I would normally not want to touch that. But because it's not a super political comic or story, I don't mind it because it keeps me centered and understand, like, even though if I might not agree with these people, even though I might not understand some of this, I still need to accept that it exists. And I need to still have, you know, a monochrome of respect for the fact that there's so many different people. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So I appreciate that.
Hey, Doc.
Yeah.
I'm the righty. He's the lefty.
Not really.
This, we sit
I'm not like really the lefty.
The same.
Now, I love hearing you say that because Rich is teaching at an art school. I teach at an art school.
Awesome.
Art university. I teach at an art university. You teach at a little art school. Yeah.
Yes, I teach at an elite fine art academy. But Rich teaches commercial art, penciling, design work, you know, all the real classical hardcore stuff you need to succeed in sequential art, digital creation.
Game art.
Yeah. I teach painting, impressionism, tonalism, basic composition, blah, blah, blah. So we compare notes a lot. And both of, Rich will amen this, man. I love
it. I got a question for Rich.
I love teaching art.
I got a question for Rich. If
no.
they come at you next semester and AI is on the curriculum, what are you going to do?
Why would it?
Well, nothing, because AI, if AI is introduced into the gaming industry, it's going to destroy the gaming industry, because then every idiot is going to put out a video game and it's all going to look the same.
As a teacher, if they come at you and say, we want you to put AI on the curriculum,
they won't do that.
Want you to teach it? What would you learn it, or would you go? Yeah,
there's nothing to learn. All you have to do is just type in a few keywords, and then it just.
Well, yeah, I know that, but that's not what I'm saying.
He wants to know, Rich, basically
using it in
if your supervisors came to you and said, Rich, listen, here's what you're gonna do. I want you to stop teaching real art. I want you to teach these kids how to use AI.
They would never say that, but if they did say that, I would probably say no.
Yes. Same here. I have never seen a computer hold a paintbrush and do anything meaningful with it.
No.
Yeah.
I love that eye roll, Amy. Yeah, I'm clipping that. Totally clipping that.
Sorry, I'm sorry, Rich. I didn't hear you.
You first, Amy. Go ahead.
No, you're the guest. You get.
I was just saying, how did I not know that you taught? And then, okay, so I'm around two professors. Well, then I'm in good company, because I would love to talk to you guys about anything related to your curriculum, school, or methods, or anything. At some point, I like to fancy myself a lifelong student when it comes to visual art.
Same. There's
I can help as much as whatever I can. I mean, if you've been doing this for a while, I'd like to think that you already know most of the stuff that I do, if not more. So,
well, yeah. What do you teach? You said you teach sequential art and everything. So you actually
I teach. What do I teach? I teach game art, concept art, some of the sequential art that you have to do for, I mean, mostly game related, but you can use all of those different types of things in every single form of art, one way or the other. How to create concepts, how to create characters, how to do it the right way, how to come up with concepts for any other type of vehicles or any environment or any setting. What else? Digital painting when it comes
to. But you also, Rich, behind all of that, behind all of that, Rich is also teaching the basics, you know, how to use perspective, how to use your basic shapes, proportion.
They don't teach that. They don't teach that until they get to, you see, in the UK, it's different. What we consider junior and senior year is the first 2 years of college in the UK. And then when we enter as in college or university as freshmen, they call it university. And that's like over the age of 18, 19 and stuff like that. So you teach Youngbug how to draw in person. That was awesome. Yes, I taught Vic how to draw the proper proportions of a human body. I don't know, about 10 minutes, something like that.
Usually the first 2 years of college that we consider freshman and sophomore year are just university, and then you graduate into a different,
Well, it goes like this. Like our junior and senior years in high school is considered the first 2 years of college in the UK.
Okay.
Yeah. And then from our first year in college is their first year in university.
Okay.
It's structured a little bit differently. It's a little bit more progressive, it's a little more adult. I'm sorry, go ahead.
No. I just have a lot of questions because
I ask all the time.
Yeah. So do they earn dual credits in high school then? Is that how that works towards whatever major?
I think so. It's not so much the credit thing. I think it's just the terms. They're just based on the terms. If it's,
it's a natural sequence they go through.
They go by about 10 different rubrics instead of like your average letter grades that we take care of. They go up with about 10 different rubrics, and there's like a 5-paragraph description of every single rubric, and you have to try and match that with the performance. And there's about like learning modules. There's about maybe 10 or 15, depending on which class you take. It's extensive, but it almost like an answer. It almost like it does the talking for you. You know, you're not allowed to put any type of, you really have a little bit of an issue putting in any type of nuances, you know, when it comes to grading. It's a little weird.
I feel like that's how it should be done here. I think that when you're 16, 17, you're definitely old enough to pick a major. Most people are. I was. But if you want to go to college here at that age, you really have to plan and calculate. I did. I was in college and high school, but that's because I pushed myself into AP classes, garnered the extra credits, finished out my high school credits early enough that I had days where I didn't have to go to school, so I would just go to the local community college. But that is it's extremely difficult to do that, you know? So I feel like, I feel like that should be more accessible here. You should be more encouraged to, like, hey, figure out what the fuck you want to do. Stop being a prolonged adolescent until you're 30 years old. You're old enough
right.
to make these decisions.
Yeah, the education system here is a bit more open. That's a good and a bad thing at the same time.
Yeah.
You know, in a lot of ways, because there are some students, let's just say there are some students who want to be like the lead singer, but they shouldn't be the person bringing the triangle. You know what I mean? Doing the tambourines. That's not so much in my major or my program, but in a bunch of other programs that I've noticed. It's a little bit this, a little bit that. You know, I mean, I'll explain to you off camera if you want, but I have my ups and downs about the education system sometimes here in the UK.
There's Tadpole. Hello, Tadpole. Good to see you, buddy.
Hello, Tadpole. Yeah, this guy.
You teach like an entertainment art type class.
I teach traditional art for game design.
Okay.
I'm sorry.
The first term that I have, I teach all the fundamentals. I like, just like Doc said, I teach I teach color scheme, I teach perspective, and then I teach composition. You know, all these things have to do with environment and how to lay out a page. And then at the end of the term, we're going to be, we usually just create an environment, and then we all judge by peer and by tutor as well. And then we take our little break into Christmas. And then we go into the depth of character design about how many stages there's going to be when it comes to the development of said character. And then we repeat that for any type of other type of concepts like vehicles or anything. What we're trying to do is we're trying to get them towards the gaming major, but you can do so much more just from my level alone.
Yeah.
You can take all of that and you can bring it to that next level. And what I'm trying to do also is trying to get an extra life drawing course as well as a sequential art course where you have sequential art where it's mostly for, it could be for comics, of course, but I would use it mostly for storyboarding, absolutely.
Yeah.
And that's what I pride my comic book pages on, that I can tell a story, and it doesn't have to be the most beautiful image in the world as long as we know what the hell the story is all about.
Yeah, the flow of it.
Sometimes we focus so hard on making every panel a masterpiece that we forget the panel layout itself is part of
the art. I would rather see
that's an Image Comics thing that I never subscribed to. It was just way too much rendering for no reason at all.
I agree. You know? That was one of my first jarring things when I was looking through comic books. I went and purchased a whole bunch of comic books when I started getting into this, and then viewing them online, and I'm like, how much fucking time are these artists and colorists putting into these pages? To me, it should be like, I would rather see consistent, like B-level art, but, you know, up the writing, up the storytelling, up the pacing, you know what I mean? Instead of there's not a lot of content, but there's nice images. And I'm like, I don't give a fuck, honestly. Like, I'm an artist. And you see beautiful art everywhere. It's a dime a dozen. So, like, I'd rather see the story show itself. You know what I mean?
Does that make sense? Story is what makes it.
Right. You're not going to remember, like, the picture necessarily. There's so much good art that, like, how often do you see an image that really knocks you on your ass that you're going to remember for a long time?
Thank you, Charles. Thank you.
I'd rather have a story that's memorable, in my opinion.
Tadpole says, I'm 16 in 4 days. I'm about to be a froglet. You'll be a newt.
What the fuck is a frog?
Oh, look out, newt. She's headed for the briar patch. So,
oh my God. Yeah.
Speaking of, you know, I'm kind of in a, I'm in a little bit of a quandary here.
Because what would that be?
On my show here at the coffee shop, I love to have a good time. I love to do memes. I love to do great moments in comics history. I love to talk to my guests. But I just launched a campaign, so I got to shill a little bit here.
Go ahead. So, here we go. I'm going to go grab some lipstick.
Oh, my God. Well, bring me some. let me play this beautiful bean footage here, Rich. Here you go.
Revenge, the sweetest morsel to the mouth that ever was cooked in hell.
I just got to say, I've got the coolest music of any trailer out there.
Heavy metal.
I say this because my son and I did the first part together.
Oh, no.
And some old friends of mine did the second part, the band Damage. You can find some of their stuff here on YouTube. The lead singer's been dead for a while now. He was a friend. The bass player's I contacted him. I said, his name is Steve Tuggle. I said, Steve, I really want to use, the song is called Self-Righteous Bastards. I said, I really want to use SRB in my trailer. And he goes, well, what's your book about? So I told him. And he said, oh, hell yeah, run it. So they go together wonderfully. And I love that I can't understand a word Troy is saying in the song.
That's how sometimes it's supposed to be. That's iconic. I feel like that's the whole appeal to Pearl Jam. So.
Agreed.
So that's cool, Rich. I just was asking you about the sequential art and everything, because when I was getting my second undergrad, I minored in entertainment art. So I feel like that's kind of the same thing. Like you're doing storyboarding, character concepts. Yeah, very sweet. Doc, well, are you going to... sorry. Go ahead.
Now, the one thing that I stress to my students, that if they're going to pick something, they need to pick something and they need to stick with it. They don't have to be in the game industry or anything for what I show them. If you're going to pick a certain type of thing that you want to do and you want to focus on it, make sure you figure out what it is and then focus on it with the tools necessary that are required. I mean, if you let's say you decide you want to go into storyboarding, it's obvious what you would do is you would pick up as many books as you possibly, a few books when it comes to camera movement, scene choreography, composition of scenes, perspective, all that stuff. Also, you know, you make sure that you have an idea of how camera angles, camera shots, you know, types of scenes, types of shots, types of establishing scenes and all that stuff. You have so many things that you'd have to learn from that thing. It's just like learning everything. I'm not saying it's impossible, but it does take quite a while. So it's like, and if you're going to be a sequential artist, you have to be somewhat fluent in about 3 or 4 or 5 different disciplines altogether. You know, it's a thing where it's like, I love the fact that the students have an idea of where they want to go. Some of them want to go into the game design, but a lot of them, they want to go into the entertainment arts, just like you said before, where it's that type of stuff, where it's like for gaming, where it's for movies, for TV, for animation, for education also, if you will. Because, I mean, whatever you decide to design can also be used as characters in an education program.
Right.
You know, or education software, education apps, whatever it might be, you know, and it's such a wide field where I am that you could just take what I teach and take what the other lecturers have with me as well with their respective skills. And they're all great. You take just the singular portions of what we usually show. And if anybody is worth their salt, they continuously apply it and then they use it and hopefully it gets them somewhere.
All right.
My job is to make sure that everybody gets, my job is to make sure my students do better than I ever did professionally.
So. Hell yeah. Now, me personally, when I see one of my students is actually becoming a better painter than I am, I usually slap them down to prevent that from happening. I'm kidding. We actually operate under the oldest system of art education. So it's the apprentice, journeyman, master. So you come in as an apprentice to learn. Some people do enter as journeyman because they've got some accomplishments. And then we, at the master level, to complete and become a master, you actually have to do a masterpiece.
Right.
Masterpiece doesn't mean your best work ever. It means a work of art that demonstrates your mastery over your medium and your style. So at the apprentice level, they get basic visual design, and that's composition, color theory, perspective,
anatomy.
And then when we go into the journeyman level, that's when they start specializing. Is it going to be drawing? Is it going to be painting? What style of painting? What style of drawing?
Mm-hmm.
And then, of course, at the master level, once they reach that level, then all we do is refinement.
Yeah,
when you work on the things you really want to tweak and things, and I'm delighted that the co-owner of the school was one of my first students, and she bought it out, and when she came in, I still have her first painting she ever did, and it's terrible.
But she has it,
and she has it framed. And beside that is her studies that she did. She did a Renoir study, she did a Cezanne study, and she did a Monet study. And then her masterpiece hangs next to it in the studio. And she is just wonderful, but she's also insane. She licks her paintings. I've never seen a soul do this before. You know, I told her, look up there in the top right corner. You've got kind of a hard line there where it's supposed to be soft. She goes,
"Nah." Whoa. Does she understand that there's a lot of carcinogens in a lot of these pigments? Yes.
Like, I have told her, keep your tongue off your art. Now, I've got another buddy. He will actually drink his acrylic water just to show his kids that it's non-toxic.
Fuck that.
And I'm like, listen, I did that by accident once.
I did too, trying to grab your coffee.
It does not. Listen, it doesn't taste as good as you would think. But when I was when I transitioned back to doing sequential art last year, I had forgotten a lot.
Yeah.
So I've been leveling up
as I
go. Mm-hmm. And to go from how I teach painting, you know, you're standing at arm's length, you hold by the back of the brush and you work from the shoulder, then the elbow, then the wrist, then the fingertips. Not
no.
Which is what you do when you're penciling.
It's shocking to me that you would even forget that temporarily, since you are an impressionist.
I'm here to.
How do you? That is impressionism. It's meant to be viewed from 6 feet away.
Yes. Art is always viewed at least 6 feet away. to get right here on a piece of Bristol board, working traditionally with a 0.05 lead, drawing all these little, it's extremely challenging to learn those motor skills. Mm-hmm. The art is still there. You can still see it in your head. Mm-hmm. But making your hand do it. But I remembered two things. One was I enjoy storytelling, so I get a kick out of doing it. But the second one is my students are watching, and I have to now practice what I preach, which is if you can, art is not about what you do with your hands, it's what you see with your eyes.
Oh my God, yes. I say that to people all the fucking time. And if I talk to a lot of people who are not artists, though, right? Like, when I say that, they're like, they just cannot fucking comprehend that. And I'm like, listen, because I'm sure you've had experiences where people are like, oh, I want you to draw this, but just draw it like that, or do it like how this person does it. Right. And I'm like, dude, first of all, copying someone's style is not, it's not the technical definition of, but it's spiritual, like plagiarism. It's bullshit.
It's plagiarism.
Yeah. Copying their style isn't really, but it's disgusting. I don't like that. And it also defeats the purpose of us all having our unique individual styles. So if you don't like my art, then go hire the person that does look like that. I've said that to people.
Yeah, why didn't you call him? You want his style? Call him.
Right. That's what I've said that to several people. I'm like, I'm not going to do that. I'm going to do it the way I do it. But so I had this one person who was really adamant, hired me for a project, and it was several weeks long, and they kept being like, but make it more like this person, make it more like this person, how they do this, after I've already had this conversation with them. So I had to talk to them on the phone, and I was like, let me explain something to you.
Someone says this to you, brace yourself.
It's great. Yeah. But you know how you were talking about doing the master studies. Okay. Mm-hmm. Obviously that's something I did in school as well. I did a bunch of master studies where you literally have to replicate the artwork down to the brush stroke to the best of your ability. And I told them, I was like, I can replicate this because this is my educational background. This is a skill I have. But it's never, like, as far as making a piece of art that's different, however, but still looks like it's by this other artist, if it's not an actual reproduction, it's never going to look like it's by that artist because I don't know what they're seeing. It's not that simple. It's not like, oh, we're both looking at the same sunflower in a vase painted. No, I don't know how they see how the light hits it. I don't know how their brain interprets the space it takes up. What, you know what I'm saying? Or for a human face, like the way that I break down the anatomy of a face, with the cheek pads and the tip of the nose and this and the like keystone thing here and the folds of the eyes. I see that very differently than how any other artist probably sees it. We all have ways of breaking down shapes and how it translates into your brain and then out of your hand. I cannot see what's in their head. I cannot see the world the way they see it. So I can never do art the way they do it. That's why we all make shit differently. And they seriously don't fucking get that. Like, non-artists don't get that. They're like, what are you talking about? We all see the same thing. No, you don't. You're not translating something from the real world onto a fucking piece of paper. You don't understand. I actually had a person tell me one time, well, I do understand. When I was young, I used to draw Pokemon all the time, and I filled up all these sketchbooks of Pokemon. And I was like, what the fuck? That's not the same. What the fuck are you talking about? And the audacity, obviously.
Breathe, Amy, breathe.
It's obviously would never say this to people, you know, but I'm like, the audacity. Because you would never go to somebody in any other profession and say that. Like, if you needed a surgery, you wouldn't be like, dude, I played Surgeon Simulator for like 500 fucking hours. I think I know, you know what I mean? A little bit about what you're talking about. You would never go to anybody in the trades and be like, dude, I fucking took a welding college when I was in sophomore year of high school. So obviously I know how to fix this. You know what I'm saying? Watch
YouTube video.
Yeah, right. And I'm just like, bro. You sketching shit when you were 11 years old is definitely nowhere in the same universe as what we're doing here. There's a lot of actual technical thought that goes into it.
Yeah. I had a colleague of mine who is not used to being challenged at all. And we took a drawing class together somewhat recently. And this person. Anyway, so what happened was it's like, here I am, I'm just drawing the figure, and it's like, you know, it's me, you know, and it's this other person, and she's looking over, and she's checking out, and you ever run into someone who would like to be an artist, but never really quite kind of gets there, but do all this, and then they say, it's like, you know, when I was younger, I really wanted to do this, but I decided to change into something a little bit more practical, you know, so something stupid. It's just, it's like, well, that's a defense mechanism where it's like, you know, that person wishes they can draw as good as you can.
Yes.
But what they do is they put it down and they try and infantilize it to make it seem as less significant as it is. Mm-hmm. So that this person goes and it's like, There's a way that I drew it where the hip would seem a little bit into perspective a little bit more. So if you took a look at it immediately, you would wonder if it's in the right perspective, and it was. But then she goes like this. She goes, I think the hips are a little bit lower than they should be. And this is in front of my other peers. And so I'm like, okay, what makes you say that? And then I decided to check it out. And I'm like, actually, you're wrong, because this goes over here and then this muscle over here joins into this part right on the top of the iliac crest, blah, 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 blah. And then she goes like this. She goes, I do know about this because I have a master's in fine arts. And I'm like, yeah, that trumps. I'm thinking in my head, I don't want to say anything, but I'm like, yeah, that definitely trumps the 20 odd years that I've been doing this professionally before I started teaching this. So please tell me how much better you are than me at
life. Yeah, what the fuck?
All right, boys and girls, we've reached that point.
It happens a lot. It happens a lot.
It does. Reached that point in the show. We're gonna continue with this topic when we return. We're going to take a brief break here. We're going to play some commercials for you so you have the opportunity to go warm up your coffee and get a puff, Amy.
Okay,
I'm changing my camera. I'm going to put it towards the art.
Amy?
Yeah.
Run.
Okay, I'll mute myself.
Roll that beautiful bean footage, Pops.
Hey friends, Morgan Quaid here to tell you about a little project called The Crimson Folly, a D&D-inspired comic anthology which takes place in a fantasy tavern called, you guessed it, The Crimson Folly. I'm working with more than a dozen artists from all over the world to bring this story to life through sequential comic artwork, intricate portrait pieces, sketches, and of course, words! My aim is to produce a combined comic story and art book. The first 40 pages will be a comic book telling the main story of the folly and using different artists to build out each section of the story. The art book will then contain sketches and short stories relating to characters from that story. So if you're a fan of D&D, fantasy artwork, comics, or just great storytelling, you'll love The Crimson Folly. Yes, you will.
In a world where creatures of myth and legend exist, a covert task force is charged with keeping humanity safe from supernatural threats. And when young Nancy Moon stumbles into the eternal battle between good and evil, she finds... Oh my God, will you shut up? What's happening? Agent Beckett here. Aren't you tired of stuff like that? Want something different? Roll the tape. Whoops. Sorry about that. That's a song I'm writing for my ex. Okay, here we go. Yeah, that's more like it. Alrighty. Welcome to the world of the mythicals. We have it all. Monsters. Magic. Government agents. He's the strong silent type. This guy. Ugh, gross, dude. Get some kind of cream or something. Lots of 90s style action. Pew pew pew. And that strong female lead alluded to earlier.
Mm-hmm.
Not to mention a dashing field commander with a great sense of fashion. Look at those glasses. South River Studios presents The Mythicals, Issue 1. Buy it.
Buy
if
it.
You dare. Were you canon already?
Were you canon already?
Get free?
How'd you get free?
Now beat it before I lose my cool.
So what are you waiting for? Back it today. Like right now.
Back the...
First world, come in and take a seat. Pay us no attention, it's all conspiracy. We have satire and parody, some funny, some perverse. If none of it's offensive to you, you'd be the first.
And she's not back yet. And Doc, you had an echo. I had to mute you. Did you?
Yeah. Brianna, we love you in spite of that flaw. I just want you to know that. So what we're going to do now is, as Rich, the professor, and Amy is going to draw a little bit also, or she's going to do some art. I don't know if she's going to draw or paint. Pops is going to bring up my campaign, and we're going to kind of do a little bit of this, a little bit of that with it. And kind of like we do on the Madness or on the ChromCon. Because I am, we've already done meme review, Vic. Where were you? The power of caffeine compels you. I love this kid. Yeah, we'll bring you in here in a minute, Vic. Yes, indeed. She's back. Welcome, Amy. All right, boys and girls. Pops, you run through this campaign. You do what you do, and let's pretend like I've never been on the show before.
Say what?
Review the campaign like you do on ChromCon.
I review people's campaigns.
You know what I mean. Go through it.
We're going to talk about it.
Yeah, there it is.
We're going to talk about it. You know.
We're going to talk about it. Hey, Amy, go ahead and set yourself up to do your art.
I'll try.
Okay. All right.
First thing I'm going to do is have you talk about your team, Doc. Everybody involved in the project, anybody who's doing sketch cards, whatever, yep. Anybody who's contributing something to your campaign, well, I want you to give them a shout out right now.
I've really been blessed to be surrounded by some great people. Anthony Romano has really stepped up as the publisher. He goes above and beyond for me. I cannot give him enough praise. It's one of those things, Pops, where while we're scripting, I will look at a panel and I'll say, oh, I don't like that line I put. Can you fix that for me? And I can say it to him because he's an artist. Yep, I got that. And He can do that. But he's also, he's doing marketing. He's building videos. He built the campaign page. So I'm happy with him. Carol Lee, who is just Carol in the chat, colored both of the Black Light tapestries that are available, one of the main character, Elizabeth Payne, and one of the Golem. And she did an amazing job. She's one of those that had a hidden talent. She came out of nowhere and did that. I let her out of the basement long enough to do the art, and she did a good job. And now get back in the basement and color, you monkey. We've got Jim O'Reilly, the legendary Jim O'Reilly, doing an alternate cover, which we should have in our hot little hands tomorrow, and it'll be up on the campaign page.
And I know what it's like to have Jim O'Reilly art because I have a few pieces around here.
Yeah, yeah. Jim is one of the two at the very top of the game. The other one, we have him too, and that is John Dillard. John Dillard is doing a pinup, 5x7 print, 5x9, something like that, that if you back Lightbringer 2 and Pariah, you will get it. Hey, Amit, good to see you, buddy. Yeah, it's going pretty well. Carol says, I'll chew through my foot. You can't keep me down here forever. You get back down there and you color. Carol and Kate got into it, and I think, I'm pretty sure that Carol threatened to stab Kate's eyes out with her crayons. Not sure if that's if that's true or not.
It sounds like an artist type of fight. I'm just saying.
It does. It does. And if I'm forgetting anybody, I'll remember as we go down. But yeah, that's the team. And of course, me. I wrote the thing, and I drew it. And Anthony's doing the lettering. We script together. He'll have a good idea every now and then, and he thinks he's some kind of great editor. I'm kidding. He's doing a great job as an editor. So, yeah. So, Pariah is a Blood and Mud, is a beginning of a three-part story, a trilogy, if you will. The Pariah Saga. The next book is Pariah Sanctum of Hate. And we're following the story of Elizabeth Payne, who would just a ordinary sexy girl, you know, one of those little hotties that runs off to the city, just a small town girl.
Here we go.
And she heads to the city, and she sees this. She sees a mob murder right in front of her, and she wants to do the right thing, so she goes to the police, and she agrees to testify against this guy. The DA puts her into protective custody, but that goes wrong. They find her. And they break in on her. They kill her protection detail. And she has, let's just say, the worst night of her life, at the end of which she is has her throat cut and left for dead. But they made a mistake. They should have made sure she was dead, because it turns out Elizabeth is descended from an ancient lineage of powerful witches. And she unlocks her power and she comes back for revenge. So in book one, we follow her origin, her training, learning her powers, the mob's efforts to find her because the body has gone missing, and some things happen. Some things happen.
I'm sorry, Doc, if you seen what I missed sending you something for the meme review today. So I just dropped a little something in your
inbox. Oh my God. Pops.
We'll put your inbox. I didn't just show it, right?
No, we'll pull that one up next week for meme review. Save that one.
It's in your inbox. You can load it.
Okay. All right. I'll do it then. All right. So on this page in particular, a couple of goons have been sent down to her home. They know where she's from. So they go down to the Carolina Lowcountry, which is where I'm from. And if you've ever seen the bayous of Louisiana, well, the Carolina Lowcountry looks a lot like that. So these two goons go down and they're trying to find her. And of course the grandfather covers for her. You know, he tells them, you know, she moved away. I don't know where she is. But these guys don't necessarily believe it. They park up at the top of the driveway and they're just watching the house. And that's where the mud part of the blood and mud comes in, because if you scroll down.
No, I'm reading this panel over here.
Okay. You get your read on.
You see what it says?
No.
It says, okay, Pops. Sorry to bother you.
So they're sitting up there, and basically Elizabeth is worried, you know, what are we going to do? And the Pops character is like, yeah, don't worry about it. I got it covered. So the golem shows up and, you know, squishes guy's head like a rotted pumpkin, and the other guy runs for his life. But it doesn't turn out so well for him.
Yeah, yeah.
Sweet Mother Mary, protect me. Yeah. So here's the cast of characters. There's Elizabeth, the golem. Andrei Bogdan is the grandfather. He is Romanian. Vasily Korov is the Russian mob boss. And then Knock Knock is this mysterious 7-foot-tall albino enforcer that works for Korov. But he plays a much bigger role than people realize, which they will see in book two.
Is he the golem?
Don't know, do you?
I don't know. It was actually just a guess. Colors by Matt Crotch. There's your one cover, a cover.
Look at that thing, man. Matt Crotch's colors were just off the chain. When he sent me the colors, we met backstage. There were only two little things I wanted changed, and he did them in like 10 seconds. I said, okay, there you go. I was like, what? Just amazing. I said, Matt, I don't even know what color her dress is. And he said, I'll try a few different things. Man, I got to see that outfit in every color in the rainbow in a split second. And, we went with the pale yellow, and I think that was a good choice because, you know, she's olive skinned, so it makes her skin pop. So this is the a trading card that is also a black light tapestry colored by Carol. You won against Kate. And here I was not at all happy with the golem. He was still evolving for me on the cover, but I liked her pose and I liked the background. So I redrew the golem. And if you buy the original art, you're going to get 2-for-1. You'll get 2 11x17s, the replacement golem and the original. And then this is the original art for the other card and pinup. This is Elizabeth, the lovely Elizabeth. And there will be a multitude of sketch cards, most of which were drawn on the Sunday draw stream here on the Madness. Then we've got the black light tapestries. Now, Tadpole, you need this black light tapestry hanging behind you when you come out on stream so everybody will know you're one of the cool kids. Just saying. Let's scroll on. I don't want to spend too much time on this because I want to get back into our conversation we were having. But what I would really like you to do, boys and girls, if you haven't backed Pariah yet, go back. We're offering coffee mugs. Here's the prototype in my hot little hands. You can see it's the real deal. You can get them in black or you can get them in white. This is the John Dillard crossover print that has Elizabeth and the Golem and Lightbringer crossing over. And also, I'm doing some sketch cards for Lightbringer. So the Golem print is also available, colored by Carol. And here's the stretch goals, real quick. At $5,000, the original three sketch cards are going to be turned into trading cards, and that's three of the four main characters. Three of the five main characters, excuse me. Don says, damn, I wish I had money. I wish you did too, Don, not just for my campaign. I wish you prosperity. At $7,000, we're going to do an embossed cover. At $8,000, we're going to do beanies, y'all. Now, I didn't know beanies were a thing, but people lost their freaking minds demanding beanies.
How many of them have backed him?
So far, a good number of them.
Look, we got to get to 8,000 before the beanie's unlocked. You know, if you like it that much, back the book.
Mm-hmm.
Don't just tell them, hey, you gotta have beanies. Don't tell people they got to have something unless you're going to back it.
And then at $10,000, the foil logo on the cover, it'll be embossed and foil. And I really wish I could get to a point where we're going to go color. I'm kind of torn about it because I drew the book to be black and white. Let's see. Maybe it is good that I can't back it as I would use the coffee mug for blast with things like tea or plain tablet. Oh, Brianna. Okay. First, I forgive you. You are absolved, Oman Panimanimu. Secondly, you can back it. You can back it, and you can put tea in the mug. I mean, that kind of wounded me. I'm thinking we're going to do t-shirts too. Look, man, I'm wearing the prototype t-shirt. My neighbor actually does the sublimation and the printing. She has a business. So she made me a t-shirt just for the launch party. And of course I wore it again today because why wouldn't I? And Amy was just adamant that we should have these t-shirts on the campaign. So we may do that. Right, Amy?
Yes, 100%.
See, there you go. There you go. All right. So that's it. Listen, go back, Pariah Blood and Mud. I got two backers this morning. I need to get another three or four this afternoon. The power of caffeine compels you. Yes. So what we're going to do at this time, Amy, what are you drawing? You got to show us. You're working intently. I can tell.
I'm actually not. I'm trying to figure out how to get my iPad to screen share onto my iMac right now so I could just draw. It's always technical issues.
Yeah. Listen, I had a professor who teaches IT and computer technology work with me to get my OBS to work with StreamYard, and it befuzzled him. He could not do it. So yeah. I feel your pain. Other people do it like that. It's easy. Not me. Because why? Because it's me. Technology hates me, boys and girls.
Yeah. Supposed to make things easier, but it sure as shit ain't. So whatever, dude. So,
Amy, who's going to be on your show tomorrow?
Mike Barron.
One more time, ladies and gentlemen. Mike Barron will be on. Now, Amy's show is called It's All Good. Is that right? It's All Good. Tomorrow, 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, Mike Barron, the one and only, who was kind enough to give young Tadpole some advice, which I'm going to clip that and make that into a video. Mike Barron's advice to people breaking into comics. Yeah, wow, it was good. It was good stuff.
His videos on YouTube are amazing, too, by the way, for the tips for writers. I shared some of them with my sister, who's a law student, and she actually was like, oh, my God, they're stuck in my head now, because she's a lot younger than me. So one of the things that she says all the time is literally, literally, literally. And he has a whole video on don't say that fucking word, because that's not what it means. And she's like,
I did a post the other day, this long post, and then at the end of it, I said, I tagged Mike, and I said, literally.
Yeah.
You keep using like, that word.
He said, keep I told you about that word, Pops.
Yeah. I do not think it means what you think it means.
So his videos, they're applicable for anybody, and he's very funny. I love the way that he talks and explains things. It's very refreshing.
Mike Barron could have been an amazing professor to have, don't you think?
Oh, dude.
I mean, seriously.
Yeah.
And Chuck Dixon, too. Chuck Dixon, good.
I think, yeah, he would be great to teach a writing course for sure. I would. Yeah. Be awesome. So, since we were talking about master studies, I'm just going to show you mine real quick, one of the ones I did in college. So, this is Toulouse-Lautrec. This is the painting that I copied. This was a million years ago.
Nice.
But this is the recreation I did.
Yep. And that's damn near perfect. Toulouse-Lautrec was a post-impressionist.
Yeah, I love him.
Yeah, yeah. he was a nut, he was a midget, and he was an alcoholic womanizer. So basically, he was Comics Gate.
He was fucking amazing. I know, I have some of his work here, and I have some of my other favorite artists.
If you don't pull down a Monet book, we can't be friends. Oh, Gauguin, another post-impressionist.
I love him. Yeah. I did a lot of master studies of his work when I was in college also. And then, of course, that's Toulouse-Lautrec. Of course, totally different, but I love.
Yes, yes.
Yeah. Whistler. Great. Classic.
Now, would you call Whistler kind of the Hudson River School, or how would you classify Whistler? Because I've always had a hard time putting Whistler into a category.
Yeah, I agree. I don't know.
Now, Amy, I've got a good friend, and you can look him up. His name is William Intrican. William Intrican was friends with, why did my brain just go blank? Who was the great Hudson River painter, the most famous of them all?
Don't know. Not as good on my art history as I used to be.
The woman laying in the field, reaching up toward the house that's on the hill, is his most famous painting. What is that guy's name? Chat, help me.
Okay, hold on.
Yes. Anyway, William Intrican studied with him, and he's a good friend of mine. And he sent me a print that was released in 1972, and there are only 50 of them in existence. And I have one of them.
Wow.
Hey, Fanta.
Up, oh,
no, that's Finn. What's going on, Finn? Sorry, I just saw it out of the corner of my eye over there.
You know, the Fanta always has the hearts and everything when she pops in.
Yeah. Listen, peripheral vision, okay? That's all I got to say.
Yeah.
Finn was good enough to have me out on his show this morning, and check it out, man. It was like the perfect storm. Ethan was on, and I thought, oh, hell yeah. This is a great opportunity. I'll have Ethan look at my work, and he'll go, damn, Doc, where have you been all my life? And blah, blah, blah. Oh, hell no. We had to have Risey on and talk over my ass the whole way.
So do you guys at your school, Doc, first of all, where do you teach? I did not know this.
I teach at the Bartlett Academy here in South Metro Atlanta.
Atlanta. Okay. Mm-hmm. Oh, wow. So do you guys do the first couple of years really just building up the basics and traditional medium?
Yeah. At the apprentice level, you're just learning those basics. And it's not necessarily limited by time. It's a checkpoint.
So right.
When you reach a certain stage, you can move on to journeyman. But we do teach in semesters. So your first semester as an apprentice, you're going to be doing visual design. You're going to be doing color theory. You're going to do all the stuff you don't want to do because you think you know everything about art, but you don't.
Dude, right.
This is where we do some unlearning and some learning. Yeah. And I get tickled at the young people in that one. Those that are tadpoles age. Happy birthday, KSSSS. Good to see you, my friend. They get heartbroken because their first, their first brushstroke and the Mona Lisa doesn't pop up on the canvas in front of them.
Dude, yes, I relate. I remember feeling like that.
Yeah, and they get heartbroken. And so, like, they'll be working on a piece, and I try to tell everyone, what you do in learning is just learning. You are not producing something to go home and hang on the wall. Okay. No. That's a sip and paint. That's a whole different thing. You're here to learn.
Yeah.
So they'll say, you know, my painting's effed up. It's not this. I'll take a brush and I'll make two or three strokes on their painting and get it where it needs to be. And they go, oh.
Mm-hmm.
So it's tell, show, do. I'll tell you how to do it. I'll show you how to do it. Then you're going to practice doing it.
Yeah. Yeah, when I was in art school, when I started my second degree at the private school, I remember going in because I already had a degree and I was like, I fucking know all this shit.
Yeah.
And they really bust your ass down. But yes. That was the mentality. I mean, I don't know how it is in every institution because I only have the experience where I have it. But the school I went to was, I don't know, actually, was, as far as I'm aware, really famous in the Metro Detroit area for being extremely fucking hard on you. Right. To the point where they had a pretty exceptional dropout rate. And I knew a shitload of people who dropped out of there before I went. And all of it was because they couldn't handle it, because their fifis got hurt and shit. And yeah. It can be very demoralizing. When I was in college there, I remember my husband, he said that I had like a scheduled mental breakdown every Tuesday. And every Tuesday I'd be like, I'm shit. Everything I do is shit. It is just garbage and shit. And I remember like having a professor who I really, really liked, because clearly with anything in life, it doesn't have to be education and it can be any field. You have to communicate well with somebody, yes, because if you're not getting each other, you know, if you're not picking up what they're putting down, there's no productive shit happening.
Yeah.
So I had this one professor who I really clicked with and I really understood him. So I would spend free time in independent studies in his classes while he had other shit going on doing stuff. And I remember being like, I don't get it. Like, my brain doesn't fucking understand, like, the simple English coming out of your mouth. What the fuck is wrong with me? Mm-hmm. And he like tapped me on the head and he was like, I have to rehardwire your brain.
Yes.
And I was like, okay. And I actually did that master study in his classroom while he was doing like live drawings or something. And I did a couple others and he would come over and do what you did. And I was like, holy shit, he just ruined my fucking painting. And then I'd go back into it and I was like, oh, holy shit, he totally fixed my painting.
Yep.
And after like one or two semesters of really working with him, I remember coming up to him, or he came up to me in the hall and he was like, oh,
yep,
I know what it was. I did a painting of my father, and he actually ran into my dad at a Meijer, which is like a grocery store here in Michigan. Mm-hmm. And he didn't know my dad from fucking Adam, but he saw him and he went up to him and he was like, do you have a daughter that goes to this school? And my dad was like, yeah. And he was like, your daughter's in my class. She did a portrait of you. And so when I went to school the next day, I saw him and I was like, dude, you totally rehardwired my brain. Like, I get it now. I see what you're seeing. I understand what you're talking about. You know, it all clicked. But it takes a lot. You have to I literally said all of that just to say, I agree with you. You have to fucking unlearn everything.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Yeah. And, you know, I do a lot of practical stuff too. Like, one example would be, all right, everybody put a blank canvas up. I want wet gesso on it and step back. And I'll go over and I'll just dip my brush in their palette and I'll put a couple of marks on there and I'll say, turn that into something. Mm. And, you know, go down doing that. The other things, I put barriers up between the student and the canvas because the temptation and the urge is to get in there close.
Oh, yeah.
I need you to stand back here. Mm. And I call it, you got to dance with it. You step in, you step out, you step in, you step out. So I literally had one girl who was also in ballet. She would pirouette away from it and then come back and look at it. And she would, she got it. I mean, she got it.
You do. You have to get that. I don't know. What's it's kind of sexy. You get this muscle recognition, and then like this communication with your arm and hand builds up over time. It almost becomes like automatic eventually. Every time I start a painting, I still have like that initial trepidation. But once you like get into the zone, it's like you can just turn your brain off and you're like, okay, it's really like, it gets me high, to be honest with you. It's like a high, because you're just like in your zone doing your shit.
And Andrew Wyeth. I just remembered the name.
What?
Andrew Wyeth.
Wyeth? Oh, okay.
Hudson River School. Sorry. My brain was locked up until I just had that cerebral diarrhea and it came out.
You're good. You're good, man. I bet that was cathartic for you.
it was. I was borderline stroke. I was borderline stroke, but I made it. Everybody learns differently. And I think one of the advantages I have as a teacher is my professional working career was as a counselor. So I know how to connect with people and I know how to build that therapeutic rapport, which is exactly the same as an educational rapport.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, you got to meet people where they're at to get into their brain. And so I won't say I enjoy teaching as much as I enjoy doing, but they're neck and neck.
Yeah.
They're very
easy. I would love to teach people. I don't feel that I'm at the place where I know enough to be able to do it, but I don't think that's actually true. I think that's just like your second guessing thing. I think I could really teach people. Cause I have like a several hundred thousand dollar education and I'm like, I could teach people this for free. Mm-hmm. It's not, I mean, it's a lot, it's technical, it's complicated, it's a lot of material, but if you have the actual drive, if I had somebody who actually had the drive in front of me, I could teach them. But I don't know. I also subscribe to this idea that you do have to have some level of inborn talent. I don't know. I've met a lot of people in school that are like, anybody can be an artist. I don't believe that. I don't believe that personally. I don't think so.
Well, here's how I look at it. The ability to produce art comes in three ways. One is you're just born with it. That's talent.
Yes.
You're born with it. You can just do. The guy in
to refine, though, I don't think there's anybody who's born a good artist, but they have that, they have something. Yeah,
it's like in Good Will Hunting, the guy just says, I could just always do it. It was just there. The second one is you have talent for learning.
So
you catch things quickly and you can do. And then there are those that just put their nose to the grindstone and they work their ass off and they finally get it. Now I will tell anybody and everybody, and this has always been an open challenge, I can teach anybody to paint. Anybody. Mm-hmm. And I've never been wrong. I've had the most inept people tell me, I can't draw a stick man. Well, that's good, because we're not going to be doing stick men. I can't draw a straight line. Neither can I. That's what rulers are for. I can teach anyone to paint, because I'm going to teach you how to see.
Yeah, I guess if you have somebody who's really willing to dedicate what all that entails, which can be really, for people who've always known art was the only thing they wanted to do, it's daunting. So to take somebody else who doesn't have X, Y, and Z, it would be extremely difficult. I guess that's the one thing that stops me from believing that anybody can be an artist or whatever. I think anybody and everybody is creative. I'm strictly talking about visual art, you know. The one thing that stops me from believing anyone could do it is just because you literally have to get brand new eyes. You have to get brand new eyes. And then you have to learn how to communicate that to your brain. And then you have to learn how to communicate that to your hand. And it is a lot. It is seriously a shitload of understanding how all of the physicalities work. The pressure. You know, what type of brush tip to use, what size of brush, what size of medium, when to add more medium to the paint. And it's a lot of physical feel. You have got to develop these fine-tuned instincts.
Yes.
So
if you were born with that innate talent, you're going to have instincts. And when I'm teaching, like at the journeyman level, I'll have students and I'll watch them like a hawk. And there was a lady, she was an older lady, and she was in that class, and she was a good painter. But I would see her, she would mix a color on her palette with a brush, and she would go, and she would stop. And I would go, why did you stop?
Yeah.
What were you about to do? And she goes, well, I was about to. I said, do what you were about to do. Uh-huh. And she'll do it, and it was right, because her instincts were there. Uh-huh. But she didn't trust her instincts.
Right.
You got to trust. If you're an artist, trust your instincts.
Even if it was wrong, I want to see it, because then I can correct it.
Well, and again, that's the other thing, you know, dispelling fear. Okay. It's just paint. Nobody's going to die.
Right. Yeah.
It's just paint. If it's oil, you can move it around. If it's acrylic, you wait 5 seconds and it dries and you paint over it. You can't fuck it up. You just got to have the patience.
Right.
But we're at that time, boys and girls, where we're going to wrap this thing up. I want to thank Amy for coming out. Excuse me. Good conversation, always. Hell of a good artist. Good person. Welcome to the network. I got the hiccups. Welcome to the network. Rich, thanks for coming out and co-hosting with me. Kat, thank you guys for coming in. If you don't mind, do me a favor. Go back, Pariah Blood and Mud. I'm just a young kid trying to break into comics.
At least go look at it, share it, do all that shit. Let everybody see it. Because, look, it might not be something that you like, but there might be 10 of your friends that do.
Good point.
Pops, play us out of here, buddy.
I'll think about it. What do we got here? What do we got? We got some Six Gun. Want to do a little Six Gun? Yeah.
Bringing you sex, sass, and style. Buckle up and unlock your imagination for a fun adventure with these death-dealing dames. They sail the galaxy in search of spoils. The most dangerous acquisition, and the most fruitful, are the legendary Splinters of Yggdrasil. The Splinters are magical artifacts forged from the Tree of Life that wreak havoc on the universe. The missions are perilous, but the bounty is glorious. Enjoy our hyper-fictional wonderland. How is a pirate ship sailing through space? Cause magic. How do they heal so quickly after battle? Cause magic. How are they able to communicate through jewelry? Cause magic. It's all about the characters. Abbo, rough, robotic, ready. Mo, carefree, callous, courageous. Mistress Graven, daring, diplomatic, dominating. Betsy, academic, accountable, aristocratic. Nefara, ancient, assured, adrenaline junkie. Bruto, proud, prominent, protective. Fisty, independent, incendiary, invigorating. Roxy, superficial, scarred, secretive. Once you get to know this diverse crew of mythical miscreants, you'll be anxious to find out what trouble they'll get into on the next episode. Go to AbboGrizzly.com and order both halves of the first episode today.
Mickey, Barry, Sloppy, and Stig are back.
In Misfits Clubhouse, sharks, dragons, and little red wagons. Our lovable quartet knows how to turn anything into a big adventure.
And this issue is no exception.
They have a face-off with the ever-feared Old Man Willie.
There's a beach bash bonanza in their future.
And we also get to meet for the very first time their favorite TV hero,
Bruce McTutherson,
aquatic investigator. This campaign will have multiple collectible covers by awesome artists.
And as you'd expect from us, some unique swag. We hope you'll stick around.
Come on in and hang out in the clubhouse.
Join along in the shenanigans.
Comic Books for Kids provides comic books to kids in hospitals and cancer centers across the U.S. It's a place where we can all work together to make sure every child has a comic book. 100% of all proceeds go towards the kids. It's about making a difference, and while they're in the hospital, allowing them to fly like a superhero, battle dragons, or rescue teddy bears. We are in every state in the country, and now support over 160 hospitals. Every month, we add more.
Visit cb4k.org.